this mission to help people in need. Amen? So that's alternative gift ideas, and we thank the Outreach Committee for putting that together. And I think that's all the announcements this morning. Let's turn to each other, let's look each other in the eyes, and let's smile. Amen? Try to find someone that you don't know. Some of you, maybe that'd be easy. Try to find someone you don't know and say, "Peace the Lord be with you." Amen. Peace the Lord be with you.
I know.
Sue, I know. Kim, I know. Ryan, I know. Peace the Lord be with you. Peace of Christ.
Can I get it?
Amen. Marilyn, Cindy, Lynn, Claire, Fran, peace of the Lord be with you. And now, please stand. And I want to invite everybody through those doors for coffee and fellowship after the service.
That's okay. It's mine.
You have room for one more goodie. You do. You do. More. Room for one more. Let's join together in the call to worship. It's found in our bulletin. Let's join together. I was overjoyed when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." Like faithful people of old, we gather to worship you, O Lord our God. This is where you teach us your ways, that we may walk in your paths. This is where your word of peace and justice for all people is heard and acted upon, so that instruments of war are transformed into tools of production, and nations shall not lift up arms against nations, neither shall they learn war anymore. As we hear and obey, we shall surely walk in the light of the Lord. Amen. We're going to write to our opening hymn. We're going to just sing the first two verses of Joy to the World, verse 1 and 2. Let's join together, page 246. We don't want to just go through the motions. We don't want to just act like we believe or pretend like we believe. We want to be alive in the faith. We want to hear you knocking at the door. If anyone hears my voice and lets me in, I will be a part of your life. And so, Lord, today we ask you to give us a wake-up call. Some of us didn't know we needed a wake-up call. That we're not ready. We're not prepared. And we need you to light a fire under us. We want to live every day to the fullest. We don't want comfort to be our number one. We want to be faithfulness is number one. We want to be alive in the faith today that you're calling us in this Advent season to count the days ready you will come. We know you're with us right now and you're desiring for that soul here today. Thank you, God, that you are giving to us this message to be awake and ready, because the best is yet to come. Lord, we thank you for our holiday gatherings, our Thanksgiving all together, but we know that there are times that we can still feel alone, and we just need you to move in this place, touch us. To a blessing, a place that they can hear your word and respond and say yes to you and walk with you in life every day, every moment, anywhere, anytime. Thank you, Jesus, for the gift of Advent and Christmas, and that is you, that is your presence with us. Thank you, God, for hope springs eternal. As your word says, hope doesn't disappoint us, because your love's been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. So let's now light the candle of hope. Amen. And we're going to invite a wonderful family, and we're going to ask Sharon. And we saw Ryan come from the choir. He said yes. Yes, you can clap for Ryan. It's okay. We like applause, right? Everybody needs to have a round of applause, right? And so we have Aiden, who's your buddy? Can you give me one of these? Can you go like this for me? You can leave me hanging? All right, I'm just going to come and go like that. I got to get you. All right, Aiden and I, buddies, he's a member of Bright Promises Preschool, so I see him a lot. And so, and his dad, Chris, and we got Grandma, and Kate, his mom. Chris and Kate are mom to Ryan and Aiden. They're going to light the candles today. I'm going to pass the microphone over to Sharon.
Good morning. Today is the first Sunday of Advent, the time when we prepare once again for the coming of Jesus.
We light a candle each week to remind us that Jesus brings light into the dark places of the world.
Today, the prophet Isaiah describes a future shaped by peace for all nations as they walk in the light of the Lord. We wait in hope for this prophecy to be fulfilled. We light the candle of hope to proclaim that God's light is coming into the world and the darkness will not overcome it. Let us pray. God of all nations, you spoke to Isaiah, and you empowered him to speak welcome words of peace and hope to the people of his time. We need to hear your word anew to us today, as the darkness of despair is still experienced wherever peace and hope is absent.
Strengthen us with the power of the Holy Spirit, so that we may be your prophets in this day and age, teaching your ways and lifting people's darkness through words and works of love and peace and justice. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Ryan's now going to light the candle of hope. Amen. And this family embodies hope. Amen. God's hope for the world. Thank you. Thank you. Can we hear for this wonderful family? They don't miss church. Amen. Or Sunday school or youth group. Amen. 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 All right. I'm going to invite my brother Herb to come up. And I'll properly introduce him later on. But I do want to say how much I love him so much, and he's going to give us, but we do want all the kids to come down, kids that are in the car. So Aiden, come on down, and Ryan, even though you're over at the choir, we need your help, so you have to come down before kids go to Sunday school. So come on down and have a seat right here. Listen to my big brother. He's a year older than me. He never picked on me, ever. Now, every now and then. And it was, you know, guys, we slept right near each other. Who has a roommate in your house, right? And or brother or sister. And you have to learn how to love them, even if maybe you don't always get along. And Herb and I have done that. And it's because he wants the microphone. He's trying to get the microphone. And I'm gonna reluctantly give it up. But he has a kid's sermon that we want to lift up.
Well, it's good to be with everyone. How's everyone doing today?
Welcome, Herb.
It's good to see you. Happy first Sunday of Advent. What a great celebration as we move toward, is it Halloween or Christmas?
Christmas.
That's right, Christmas. Of course it's Christmas. That's right. Well, it's good to see everyone. We're glad to have you all here. What? Do you guys hear something? What's going on? Oh no, Scruffy's asleep. And I was just talking about we were going to take a walk together, and now he's sleeping, and he loves walks. Oh no, I hope he doesn't miss it. Will you do me a favor? It's hard to wake Scruffy up sometimes. So together, we're going to, at the count of three, we're going to say, "Wake up, Scruffy." Ready? One, two, three. Wake up, Scruffy! Wait a second.
Are you supposed to let sleeping dogs lie? No.
No.
Scruffy,
let's try
looks
one
so
more
peaceful,
time.
But
one more time. One, two, three. Wake up, Scruffy!
No.
There he is. He's
hello. What's going on,
Scruffy? It's good to see you. Almost missed everything.
I love you, Herb.
Oh, it's good to see you, Scruffy.
You woke me up.
Yes, because we were going to talk about going for a walk. And
oh, a walk. I love to walk. I love to walk. I love to walk. Walk, 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 walk.
One problem
on
those. He gets distracted sometimes, Scruffy does. But you remember, Scruffy, on those walks, you have to be careful because there's that one thing you do sometimes when you chase.
Oh, yeah. Sometimes I chase cars. I really love to chase cars with tailpipes, but then I get exhausted.
Ha ha ha. Oh,
good,
that's
good one,
fun.
Scruffy. That was a good
oh,
one.
Oh, boy. Well,
I'm so glad I'm awake.
I know, Scruffy.
I'm ready for a walk.
Because we were going to go for a
I'm
walk.
I'm ready for a walk.
And
yes.
You almost missed it, and you love walks.
I'm so glad. Thank you for waking me up, everybody. Thank you so much.
Do you all like going for walks?
I would have slept through it all.
Yes, thank goodness. You know, and sleeping is hard to wake up people sometimes. You know, when we were in the same room growing up, Pastor John and I, sometimes our mother would have to come in and say, wake up, wake up. And sometimes I'd jump on John just to wake him up.
I think
just
Herb
to make
woke
sure.
Me up one time when he put a bucket of water. He just splashed me with a whole bucket of water.
Sometimes you have to do that. Well, you know, Scruffy, and I will take a walk later, but I'm going to talk with everyone about walking with Jesus, having a walk of faith and following Jesus. And it's sort of like, you know, what do you like about walks,
Let's
Scruffy?
Let's see, what do I like? All the smells. I do like the smells.
That's true.
I like to walk to see the birds and chase balls. But the best thing is walking with people.
Exactly.
Walking with my master. It's the best. It's the most wonderful thing. And I'm so glad I didn't fall asleep.
I'm so glad I
woke up because I could go for a walk now.
And sometimes, Scruffy, we've got lost, right? When we walked, we're a little lost.
We do get a little lost.
And what do we do?
I get a little distracted.
Yes. And what do we do what do we do when we walk? When we get lost,
we help each other. We do.
And so when we, on this life we lead, that's why church is so important, because look at those people out there.
Look at those beautiful people.
They're all, no matter what they look like, they're all going to help at any time. They're going to be there for you in the walk of faith. So when you come to church, it's like making sure you have people that help you in life, in the walk of life. That you never have to worry about.
I don't want to sleep through that.
Just
I
like
really don't.
Exactly. And so therefore...
Wake me up, please. Wake me up.
It's important we don't
I don't want to miss anything special.
It's important we don't get distracted. That's why coming to church on Sundays is so important, because it wakes us up to what's important. So we don't sleep in, not only just sleeping in for church, but just in our mind, just not focusing on where Jesus is calling. So I hope you'll all remember how Scruffy loves to walk and how important it is for all of us to help each other as we go through all of life.
I'm awake, and I'm ready for life.
So now we're going to say a prayer together.
Okay.
I will. Dear God, thank you for all those people who help us in the walk of faith, all those people who we hold on to us and love us, especially for Jesus, for us to be able to follow all his teachings, all his life, everything he put in our hearts, and be with each of these young people today and the not so young people as well, to let them know they have each other. They have the church to help them on that journey of life. Amen.
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 Thanks for coming up, guys. Have a great time at Sunday school.
Let's hear for our kids. Let's clap. Amen. Amen. I know, Scruffy has his own theme song that Daniel put together. So nice. Amen. All right. We do look for lay readers. If you'd like to be part of the Dream Team, which is taking part in any of our, ushering, did Charlene jump in and she's ushering this morning? Because I got a call from Marianne Farley. We need ushers this morning, and I forgot to announce, but it looks like someone stepped up and is ushering today. And I think anyone who would volunteer to help do the lay reading or ushering or singing, look at all the people we have singing in the choir. Can we clap again for the singers this morning? Amen. And so no experience necessary. It was Hope Allen's grandson, Jacob, that was the lay reader at the early service. And he's got an amazing voice. Did you hear him singing, Herb, at the early one? Early service. So let's go now to our prayer of confession. Let's join together. Amen. It's printed right here. God of light and life, you set before us today the challenge of laying aside the works of darkness, of putting on the light of Christ, of being watchful and prepared for your coming in our midst in the person of Jesus Christ. As the people of God in this place, we know that a crucial part of our witness is in revealing Christ to the world through the way we love and care for one another. Forgive us if people do not see any evidence in us of the one who is to come. So many people, young and old, grope in the gloom of despair and suffering, yearning for the light of hope to dawn in their lives. Remind us that the light of Christ shines through people like us, people who claim to follow him. Merciful God, cleanse our hearts and minds of all that hinders us from loving you and loving our neighbor. May our lives radiate faith, active in love, as we watch and wait for your breaking into our world once more in the person of Jesus Christ. Amen. And the assurance of forgiveness. Salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. The day of salvation is experienced as we lay aside the works of darkness and put on the protection of the light of the world, Jesus Christ, in whom and through whom we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. And so thank you for those ushers who will now take the plate, Jackie and Charlene. And as we take up this morning's offering, we're going to sing a beautiful song. It's called Go Light Your World. And I want you to just hear the lyrics as they encourage us to do exactly that. Go light your world.
Darkness, seek out the hopeless, confusing. Frustrated brother, see how he's trying to light his own candle some other way. See now your sister, she's been robbed and lied to, still holds a candle without a flame. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the homeless, confused and torn.
Join together in the doxology as we present our offering to God this morning. Stand if you're able. Let's join together. To strengthen your holy church here in Osterville and around the world. Amen.
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 Amen. Let's join together in singing the first Noel. We're going to sing just the first two verses of this song. The first two verses, page 245.
So deep.
Please be seated. Amen. So, before I read the lesson from Romans chapter 13, actually, I'll read it and then I'll introduce Herb, okay? I love him so much. I love him so much. You've already heard a lot of Herb's stories. You really have. In just 5 months? Is that all? Who can do the math? How long have I been here? Since July 3rd was my first Sunday. And you probably have heard, I don't know, Herb stories, but they are so beautiful, the Herb stories, right, Sarah? Sarah's is Herb's wife, so amen, amen. In fact, where's I typed up some, I had another joke, but Herb said, don't say it. So I'm like, I said, my people love to laugh. We need to rejoice. So Scruffy was going to say, besides the one, you know, that
I like to chase cars, you know, but when I get to the tailpipe, I get exhausted.
Besides that one, Scruffy was going to say,
why does the man eat yeast and shoe polish before he goes to sleep?
Why, Scruffy?
So that he can rise and shine.
All right. Claire's like, I don't know. You just throw it out there. Maybe it'll work. Who knows? All right, we're going to. It is hard to give Herb the mic. Once you give it, then it's, you never know. All right, so we're going to read the lessons. I'm going to read the Romans 13, then Herb's going to read the gospel and then preach to us today. So Romans 13, 11 to 14, and Herb wanted me to read, and we found this Bible in the parlor here at the church, and I didn't know there was a Wirral Bible. See that? Wirral? And it's the lectionary NRSV, the New Revised Standard Version. And so the heading is An Urgent Appeal. Besides this, you know what time it is. How is it now the moment for you? How is it now the moment for you to wake from sleep? For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone. The day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in revelry and drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. And so I want to introduce Herb because he's going to read the scripture and go right into it. So Herb is one of my great heroes of the faith. He always has been there for me. He's just a year older than me. And we really, like Herb, I think during the kids' sermon, we slept right next to each other. And I almost could reach out and touch him from my bed to his bed. So my whole growing up, Herb was always there. When he went to Bates College and I spent that first night alone in that room, I still saw him in the bed. I could still hear him snoring and making all the Herb sounds. One night I remember, because we would laugh when we grew up, he drank so much water that he could just move his stomach like this. And it was so loud, you could hear it just going. And we were laughing so hard. My mom came in, keep it down, keep it down. But when he went off to Bates College, it was tough. I cried because I thought, okay, from now on, things are going to change. And that's okay. That's part of life. But he and I have grown closer through the years. Yes, we've been competitive. And I said at the early service, do you remember that the label maker that you could make that was sticky and it was like plastic and it was a little wheel and you'd pick the letters, and so we each got one of them. We had one, and all we would write was John's the greatest is what I was write. I would write, and he would write Herb is even better. He's the greatest, and he'd stick that on my stuff, and I'd stick John's the greatest on his stuff.
But we really, we're competitive now, but it's all love. But we grew up in the church, and if you took the church away from our life, who knows where we would have been, you know, where we would have gone in life. But Herb always beat me in most things. Let's put it, and last week I did revel in the memory of beating him in Monopoly, but it was only once, and it was funny because Blaine and Emily and others, is that Monopoly game still going? Is that still at my mother's house? But anyways, so I just want to say, you know, Herb went off to Bates College, and then he worked, and then he went to Harvard Business School, and he was working in big business, but then God said, I want you. And then he heard a calling to be a pastor, and he went back to school to get another master's degree at Boston University School of Theology. And he's always had a ministry in my heart. I've always seen him to be someone who carries the light of Christ out in the world. He's not perfect by any means, but I just thank God for him every day. He's always there for me, always been loving and supportive. I'm so happy. I'm so happy that he and Sarah actually have pledged to the church. I'll end on that. No, but they took a pledge card. Actually, I filled it out for them. And
I told
you'll find out how much you're giving annually, but complete trust. But anyways, Herb is somebody that is so well accomplished in life in general. He thinks he's retired. He retired young, but he's probably busier now than ever before. And one of the things he's busy with is the work of the Lord. So everyone, Herb Taylor.
I want to clap.
Amen, amen.
Thank you, John. It's always hard when another preacher comes in, the pastor has to do a pre-sermon before the guy comes up.
You got to wear this.
Oh, yeah.
This is George's. I want to make sure George can.
All right. So it's good. It's so such a blessing to be with you today and to celebrate and to worship and to just come together with this church as always. The gospel passage is from the 24th chapter of Matthew, the 36th through the 44th verses. But about that day and hour, no one knows, neither the angels of heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. For as the days of Noah were, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in those days before the flood, there was eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing, then they knew nothing until the flood came and swept them all away. So too will be the coming of the Son of Man. Then two will be in the field, one will be taken and one will be left. Two women will be grinding meal together, one will be taken and one will be left. Keep awake, therefore, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. Therefore, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us be in the spirit of prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength, our rock, our love, and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, I hope all of you had a wonderful Thanksgiving. This Thanksgiving, we were at the Cape, on the Cape here with my mom at her house with family, and it was a wonderful time. Now, a little different for that we've done in the past, because for many years, Sarah and our family drove down to Washington, D.C. to have Thanksgiving with Sarah's sister and her husband, and it was a wonderful time. Sarah's parents would come up from Florida and meet us sort of halfway there in D.C., and we'd have Thanksgiving together, and it was a beautiful tradition that we did for many years. We also were part of another tradition that I'm sure that many of you have been part of over the holidays, a long drive. We took that long drive down to Washington, and then on either a Saturday or Sunday, would take that long drive back to Massachusetts, where in our car, often was the case, both Sarah and the boys would be asleep for much of that trip, except for the times when Sarah would wake up
and say to me, are you awake? And watch where you're going, of course, would be the other part, she'd say. Often by the time we'd get home, the boys would be completely asleep, and we'd have to, you know, get them out of the car, and you'd reach out in that car, and I still have that smell of what their heads would smell like after sleeping and heating up for a while. Sort of, their heads still smell that way. It's sort of hard since they're about 6'6 and 6'7 to kind of get to their heads. But if you could, their heads still smell the same way. And we'd say, okay, when we reached in when they were little, and said, it's time to go. We have to get inside. They'd like hunker down. No, you know, it's cold. Have you noticed it's cold outside? I don't want to go outside. Let's just stay here. And it would be like any time when we needed to rouse them, get them going. They'd like, I don't want to move. It's comfortable. I like it exactly where I am. And of course, still today, it's the same way with Sarah. When I try to wake her up, it's the same way. But there's no question, it's hard to wake up sometimes. And I ask you, how do you wake up? Do you love that snooze button? Or, you know, when the sun comes up, do you roll over and put that pillow over your head and let some more time pass? And yet, there Jesus is in our gospel passage this morning from Matthew, and there Paul is in that letter to the Romans, saying it's time to be awake. Jesus and Paul know how we can all be at times in our lives. It's easy to get complacent. It's easy to lose focus. As we gather together for Advent this morning, the beginning of Advent, Advent is a time when we ask ourselves, are we ready? And not only are we ready for celebrating Christ in Christmas, but also are we ready? Are we prepared for Christ coming alive in our life every day? That's really what Advent's about. Asking us to think together, are we ready for Christ to come alive? Not as a part of past history, but are we ready to think about Christ alive in our hearts? Sarah loves to tell the story about how one time I must have set the alarm wrong, and I must have been stressed out about something, but the alarm went off in the middle of the night, and I jumped out of bed. Okay, I'm ready to go. I'm ready. What's going on? Sarah said, go back to sleep. It's middle of the night. And I'd go back to sleep. But Advent is like an alarm going off for us. And really, not only Advent's like that, you might say church every week or every time we gather for any aspect of church. It's a time for us, as we do church together, to remind each other just how easy it is to nod off, just how easy it is to get complacent, to go spiritually back to bed. Now, I don't think Jesus in our passage this morning was talking only about the second coming. People, I think, get a little too preoccupied with all this sort of end of the world stuff. But the reality is, as Jesus said anyway, no one will ever know what that day will be anyway. Right? Jesus makes that clear. The scriptures make that clear. So the important thing, I think, for us is not just to be ready for the last day, but be ready for today. Be ready for every day. Because again, Jesus knows the reality of the world we live in, with its challenges, both, you know, globally, nationally, with the challenges we face personally, the distractions that we face every day of our lives. This is what Jesus is getting at, I think. And really, if you go a little further in our gospel, move from the 24th chapter to the 25th chapter, I think in what we read, Jesus is just setting the table for the 25th chapter when he talks about how, as you've done for the least of my brothers and sisters, you've done for me. The hungry, the thirsty, the stranger, the imprisoned, the sick. What you've done for them, what you've done for the other children of God in our life, you've done for me. The point is that Jesus is around us, not just one season of the year, but every day. We don't need to speculate about the future. We don't need to worry about the end of the world. You know, I remember when John and I used to get into elevators when we were little, right? John would say to me, do you think if it falls, can we jump up right at the end and we'd be okay? John was a little, you know, John was a little slow, man. And that's what we think, you know, we'll just wait until the time's right. We'll jump up. Jesus wants us to rise up every day, to not wait for some end of time, whether it's our time or the world's time. The time is now for us to be the people of God, the brothers and sisters of Christ we are called to be. We're called to look around and respond to Jesus alive today in and all around us. Jesus is saying, you never know where or how or when I'll show up, but keep awake, be alert, be ready, be on watch. Advent is about believing, even expecting that we have a God that's always there. But also remembering that we have our work to do, right? That this Christmas story isn't about just history, it's our story. It's a story of the way God becomes incarnate in us. And how through that, we become the body of Christ as the church. You are the body of Christ together as the church, as the United Methodist Church of Austerville. And as that body of Christ, you are called to live and to breathe and have your being as a people of faith, as people who walk in faith together. And you, whether you know it or not, you need each other. And that's why it's so important to be here on Sundays and to feel that sense of God's presence alive for you. Because there, even if you don't need it, there's someone, maybe they're sitting, don't look around, but sitting next to you or behind you, who need it and need to feel your presence with them. And to know that they need not fear, that God is with them because they hear you singing. They hear you praying. They feel you worshiping and knowing and believing that God is alive. I might not have felt that this week, but I came to church and I feel God alive. But good, I hear the good news. No matter what bad news, finite bad news is going around, I have that infinite good news. You know, I was watching the Celtics the other day, and I know my mom's watching. She definitely watches the Celtics every day, every time they're on. And when I was watching, I was not only thinking about playing basketball myself in the olden days, but also thinking about coaching Blaine and Ben when they were littler, or actually all the way through their lives. And one of the things I always told to my team is that, you know, even if you're not one of the five that are playing at any one moment, you need to be in the game, right? You need to be ready. You need to be keep awake, because you never know when you're called. You know, Peyton Pritchard, if you know the Celtics, or Hauser, or any of those folks that are on the bench, they can't be like looking around and the coach calls them. They're like, whoop, I forgot to put my shorts underneath my my sweatpants. No, you need to be in the game. You need to be watching, understanding what's happening. And the same is true for all of us. Jesus says to each of us, we need to keep our head and our heart and our soul in the game, in life. We need to be looking around, noticing those in need around us, the great needs of this world that we live in, but also maybe someone in your home or in your neighborhood or at your workplace, or maybe someone just needs a smile. Maybe someone just needs an encouraging word. Maybe someone just needs to know that God is alive for them. Someone needs to know that there is a person of faith next to them so they can remember that that faith that is alive within them is just a spark. Someone needs a candle to light in the darkness, to believe that someone holds that candle. You know, at times on long drives, one might not appreciate someone who asks you every few seconds, are you awake? Watch where you're going.
But how important that is on the spiritual journey, that we know that we have people with us who care enough about us, who love us enough, who share that sense of being a brother or sister in Christ, who's going to ask us or help us along the way. In our lives, we need to be asking ourselves, and this is how coming to church helps us. Are we awake to what's happening around us? Are we aware of what Christ is calling us to do? How are we doing in our walk of faith? There's always a lot to do in our lives. There's a lot that is going on, a lot to distract us. We need to be about prioritizing our life, our faith. And we need to ask ourselves, does your calendar reflect that? Does your time reflect that? Does your calendar show that you're taking advantage of what this church offers you to grow and to serve and to give? And as Jesus knew, as he talked about money all the time, does your wallet, does your checkbook, does your pocketbook, does your giving of yourself, does your pledge, I know Pledge Sunday was a while ago, does that reflect your direction, your priorities, that you're awake and ready as part of this body of Christ to be a part of something special that's not a part of history, but a part of something today and into the future? Because you are part of something special. You're part of the body of Christ alive today here in this community and beyond. Are you letting faith direct your life? It's hard sometimes to be on the right direction. I remember the story I heard or read once about a battleship who spotted a light ahead of them that seemed to be heading straight for them. And so they sent out a radio message. Unidentified ship, you're on a collision course, change direction 10 degrees. The reply came back, no, you need to change direction. The battleship sent another message again, this is a U.S. warship, change direction 10 degrees starboard. Once again, a reply came back, that's impossible, you change directions, we can't do it. Now they really were nervous, so they go down and wake the admiral, who happened to be in the ship. And the admiral wakes up, comes upstairs, and sends a message. This is a warship on official maneuver. You are ordered to change direction. Signed, John Peacock, Admiral. A moment of tension passed, and finally the reply comes back, which simply says, no. Signed, Sam Nedick, Keeper of the Lighthouse. You know, often as we see our life in the light of Christ, we know we're headed either in the right direction or in the wrong direction, right? And the light of Christ, as we see our life in the light of Christ, we recognize maybe we need to change course, and maybe we even recognize for others that it's time we need to help those people change course. As Paul said, the night is far gone, the day is near. The day is near, and I have good news for you, because you have a light that shines within you, that shines for you, and that shines through you. You don't have to look someplace else at some lighthouse. You have that light inside you as a child of God. All it takes for us is to feel that light, and that's why it's important to be a part of a church family, because we help each other feel that light. So don't delay whatever it is that might be keeping you from walking with Jesus in your life. It's time to redirect, to put on the armor of light, as Paul talks about, to think about the strength and the vision that provides to you when you
have and feel that light inside of you. It doesn't just prepare you for the hustle and bustle of the Christmas season. It prepares you for life, for all of its ups and downs. So don't wait till tomorrow to be awake and ready for the walk of faith, because the reality is that Jesus lives for you today. Do you believe that? That Jesus, not only Jesus came for the world, that's a good thing, but Jesus came for each of you today so that you could believe that the love of God, a God that sometimes can be seem so far away, the love of God is for you as an individual. To know that and to believe that. Heaven and earth may pass away, everything might change, but God's love through Jesus for you and for our world will never pass away. Are you ready and awake to that good news and to how it can direct your life, how it can make a difference in your life and in the life of others, how it can make a difference for you and for this church, and how this church can help you on your journey? To be awake, to be ready for the walk of faith. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we just thank you for bringing us together on this day for this time of worship. We thank you for all the ways that we can help each other along the walk, all the ways we can respond. And I know, dear God, that there might be someone here who's thinking, this person's not talking to me. I'm having a tough time. I'm feeling a dark place. And I just pray that that person, whoever he or she is, they might hear this word that God calls your name. That God speaks to you and wants you to know that you need not fear, that nothing in all of creation can separate God from you. And that you're in a church that's going to remind you of that. And that you're an important part of this place. And everyone here, dear God, let them feel that message for them today. Because every one of us at different times in our life might feel a little down. But we are called to lift each other up, to be ready to be that love that you put in our hearts. So, dear God, as we move through this Advent season, as we move through this year ahead, as this church takes on this year ahead, let them come together as people of God and let them make a difference. We thank you, dear God, for those who have been a part of this place, whose legacy continues to live within this place. But their legacy is important because of the way this church today and tomorrow takes that, builds upon that firm foundation of faith. We thank you, dear God, that someday, many years from now, when we're all gone, that there'll be people here gathering and worshiping and learning and growing and giving and making a difference because of what the people of this church do today and will do tomorrow. Continue to guide them and bless them. And let this church shine. Let this church lift its candle. Walk into any darkness that might feel overwhelming and know that no darkness in the world can ever overcome the light of one candle. And we thank you, dear God, for the way the light of this place shines brightly. And it's with this good news we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thanks, sir.
Amen, amen. Praise God. We have some,
just a couple prayers to lift up, and then we're going to sing Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. And thanks, Herb. I was just watching the back of your head. I love the back of your head. It's just so beautiful.
Did I say that at the early service?
Oh, I did, yeah. Herb was sitting in a spot that the light was directly on him, and I talked about the reflection, you know, getting in the way of everybody trying to worship. But anyways, we have just a couple prayers to lift up. We want to pray for Sandy Grayson, who was a member of our congregation for many years. She died this week, and we want to lift up Dick Grayson and family. And there will be a service at the Greendale People's Church in Worcester on December 3rd, December 3rd at 11 a.m. And we just want to make sure we do everything we can to surround the family. But we celebrate Sandy's life of faith and that she is at peace. And God worked through her in this place. We thank God for them. And we've been watching the news, and I won't go into anything particular, but whenever you watch the news, you could just feel, you know, the darkness kind of coming. And it's, you fight that by just, and we're going to run out of candle if we keep going, because look at that. The candle of hope is going fast, and we're going to light that every week. Candle of hope and of peace and of joy and of love, and then at Christmas Eve, the Christ candle. And so we might have to get more candles, and if we have to do that, we'll do that, amen? But I was thinking of Herb's message about being awake and how you can be physically awake, but not spiritually and not in your heart and in your soul. You can feel exhausted and tired and worn. You have to be proactive in your faith. And so I'm challenging you during this Advent to pray in the morning before you get to doing whatever you're doing. Take a moment. And who can tell me the acronym PRAY? Praise. Make sure you give thanks to God every day. R, repent. Repent. George is remembering. Repent. Confess your sins. Get right with God. Feel that grace come into you. And what's A, George? Ask. Ask. Don't be afraid to ask. That's what God says. Ask and it shall be given to you. Seek, you'll find. Knock, the door will be open. And what's why? Do this in the morning, all through Advent. Why is yield? Yield. Surrender to God's will, right? And that darkness is going to go because you're busy lighting the candle of your faith by being with God in prayer at the beginning of the day. So that's how we wake up and be alive in the faith. So we know we have other prayers to lift up. We're glad Barry's with us. Yes, Daniel, start playing. Start playing. Barry's with us. He's recovering from COVID. But while he was away recovering, his good friend Clifford died. And we love you, Barry. Clifford was 97, lived a long life. Barry was good friends. They were very close for many years. We pray for you. And my mom, I was hoping she was going to be here today. Ben, I said carry Grammy. I said carry her to the car and get her. She's watching, and we love you, Mom. If I say Grammy, she goes, I'm your mom. Call me Mom. So, Mom, I love you. We love you and everyone here. It's four Sundays in a row that she was not. She turned 91 this week. We had such a celebration. I can't thank you enough for loving her. To know my mother's loved. And it's sad to think anybody could be out there and not part of a community of faith and of love. Because you might have a good family, you might have people. Others might not. And this Advent, reach them, invite them. When our dad died 28 years ago, this church was there for my mom. We knew where my dad was, right? He preached it right from his pulpit, the gospel, the good news. And so every Sunday we hear the good news. And you're, like Herb said, you're the body of Christ. We're the body. We embody that good news. Amen. I went with Don this week on Wednesday, Papa Don. If you saw the photo on our Facebook page, he got his, you could put him on, you could put on the Santa hat. He's Papa Don Santa. For 12 years, Don has been going to Hyannis on Main Street. For 12 years, 3 days a week, and he would buy any homeless person breakfast in the morning. And he would give them socks that we collected and coats and hats. He is the living Santa, is among us right here. But I went with him this Wednesday, and we had such a great time. It wasn't a lot, but I actually, on behalf of the church,
bought him breakfast. For the first time, someone bought him breakfast. He can't count how much money he spent feeding hungry people more than food, because I witnessed it and I was just tagging along with Papa Don. But we just thank God that we have folks in our church who do that. And if you have any questions about how you can help, you can talk to Don. But I hope you had a great Thanksgiving week with family. Hope you're feeling like you ate too much. That's a good feeling, I think. Then you get back to the way it should be, not overindulging. But let's overindulge spiritually, amen? Don't go to sleep in the faith. Right, Pastor Rebecca? Right, John? Don't let me do that. Ted, I'm not going to let you do that. Do you know that yesterday, how long did we think we wouldn't have power in church today, Ted? Hours. How many hours? While they were decorating, Lisa and Sandy and Ellie, they were putting all these decorations up in the dark. Not the dark, because the light was coming in the windows. But we didn't know because something went wrong. In fact, right now we're only going on half power pretty much. There's two power lines coming in. And you were there, Ted, with me and the Eversource person and the two electricians. God bless Fuller Electric. They said, we've never seen anything like this. Someone's trying to cut power off to our church. But it's not going to happen because we have the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen, choir. Amen, Ryan. Amen, Kim. And Sue, Dawn's better half, better three quarters. Amen. That we have the power of God's love. And I just thank God for all of you. It's back on. We're going to work on whatever the other problem was, but there's a little burnt thing. It looks like a lightning strike. And we're going to work on the lights. But yesterday they said, we don't know if any of these lights work. We plugged them in afterwards. There's a photo of Ted pointing. Most of them work. We're focusing on the ones that are lit. And we need more lights on our tree. We need even more lights in our church. Invite someone to come to church with you. Amen. And we want to pray for Stephanie Tennis's brother who had a pacemaker put in. And he's doing well. He's back home. Stephanie is such an angel for her brother. We have a lot of people to pray for I'm going to talk more before the prayer than the prayer, because I know we have coffee hour. And we want to lift up Carl Riddell because he is on the Cape. Amen. It's going to be just about 6 months. And Sharon's right there. This past week, right, he walked on his foot for the first time in 6 months. Can I hear an amen? Amen? He needs hope. Send him a note, give him a call. He really thrives when he knows people are thinking about him. And we got to keep lighting that candle of hope. Al Narbonne, we pray for him. We pray for others who just need to know, keep the hope going. Hope does not disappoint us. Let's pray. Don, did you want to say anything else? Who is that gentleman? Mark Bonbell that you knew. He's a brother Mason, Mark Bonbell. There's other prayers. He's with God right now. Let's pray. Keep playing, Daniel. Let's pray. Put your hands out. If you're comfortable with your position, put your hands out. You came to church today. Let's pray. We came to church today. There's somebody who needs to receive. They're good givers, this person. Today, they need to receive. And we thank you, God, that we ask for a blessing on each of us, that we would receive your love, your hope, your peace, your joy, to carry it out into the world. Thank you for your grace that's poured upon us again and again and again. Forgive us for being asleep, to be half awake in the faith, or three quarters. We want to be fully awake in the faith, that you would bless us this Advent and move through us to help us be the light in this dark world. We see the darkness, but the darkness shall not overcome your light. And we thank you for your power, your love, that continually should wake us up to service and mission and praise. Help us get on our knees if we can. Help us to pray in the morning and be
before we go to bed, help us to get into your word. Bless every church everywhere around the globe who's seeking to be your hope in this dark world, your light, as we lift up your prayer saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Please stand. Let's join together in Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. Daniel's going to go to the organ. The lyrics are on the screen. It's only two verses. Please stay after. Come on Wednesday for our annual meeting. We're going to have fun. I guarantee it. We're going to have some fun. Let's sing together. Come Thou Long Expected Jesus. Amen. Lives for you forever. Amen.
Amen.